Hello everyone, today we're going to talk about the abuse of statistics by creationists. So, let's jump right in. In many conversations I've had with creationists, I've found, and I'm sure others have as well, that when they are unable to refute some point about evolution, they make up some gigantic number that is supposed to represent the probability of some event happening. The problem is that we rarely get explanations as to how they came up with these probabilities. There is almost never any data indicating the probability of some event occurring, so creationists assert that the chance is equivalent to rolling dice or flipping a coin. There are many problems with this line of thinking, and to look at them, we'll make an example of the video, Origin, Probability of a Single Protein Forming by Chance.
When applied to the origin of life and the random formation of large biomolecules, probability theory clarifies the limitations of chance as a creative agent on the primordial Earth.
Who worked out the probabilities associated with abiogenesis? I must have missed that paper. All we have are researchers who have performed experiments testing the ability of certain chemicals, such as amino acids, the building blocks of proteins, to form under specific conditions. No one is trying to create life in the lab. The Miller-Urey experiment was one of the most famous of these, testing the Oparin-Haldane hypothesis of the early Earth formulated in the 1920s and 30s, which did what was expected of it. The proof of concept that amino acids could form in prebiotic conditions. Today, researchers continue to test hypotheses about organic molecule formation in the Earth's early history, but the hypotheses have become more refined as more data about the early Earth has come in. And none of these hypotheses include randomness as the driving mechanism behind this process, thus attempting to disprove abiogenesis by calculating the probability based on the assumption of pure randomness is nothing more than making an absurd straw man. Regardless, no one knows the probability of life forming through abiogenesis, and no one has tried to work it out. Thus, asserting probability theory has some say on it is quite a stretch.
For example, what are the odds a single protein could form exclusively through the blind interactions of chemistry?
Who knows? You certainly don't. And again, while chemistry is blind, it is certainly not random. There are other problems with the assumptions being made here, but more on that later.
Our target is one smaller than average molecule made from 150 amino acids, each aligned to ensure a folded chain. Researchers have calculated that on the ancient Earth, the probability of success was one chance in 10 to the 164th power.
Who determined that? According to your sources, Stephen Meyer did, the well-known anti-evolutionist. In fact, all of the video's sources are anti-evolutionists. Stephen Meyer, Douglas Axe, James Kopej, and James Tour. All intelligent design proponents with an axe to grind. Pun intended. You don't cite any papers by authors working in the relevant field, such as John Sutherland, Bill Martin, Nick Lane, Liam Longo, or anyone else. When you go into an argument having only looked at one side, never having heard the opponents, you're going to run into trouble. This is that trouble. For starters, there is a covert assertion being made here, that this smaller-than-average protein would have been useful to early life. Has anyone actually determined that it would be? No. The simplest or smallest modern organism is still a modern organism. It is still part of a lineage that stretches back billions of years, making it just as evolved as we are. Every protein you see today, no matter how small it is, has been shaped by millions of years of evolution. Similarly, has anyone determined what the smallest, while being potentially useful, protein is? Also, no. The video is assuming properties of ancient life when there is no data available. What we do have is decades of research indicating that amino acids, as well as nucleotides, carbohydrates, lipids, and other organic molecules, form readily in various solutions. I laid out in my video, Abiogenesis Part 2, a hypothetical method by which organic molecules could form naturally that is primarily based on Nick Lane's book, The Vital Question. This book is, in turn, based on decades of work that has pushed the origin of life to deep ocean alkaline vents, which make the ambient water extremely basic. This basic water, combined with the more acidic ocean water, containing much dissolved carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, could then mix to form simple organic molecules. Lane has shown that mixing these two and catalyzing the process with minerals that naturally occur along alkaline vents yields formaldehyde, formate, ribose, deoxyribose, and other simple organic compounds relevant to the origin of living systems. A recent paper titled Redox and pH Gradients Drive Amino Acid Synthesis in Iron Oxyhydroxide Mineral Systems shows how amino acids can form entirely naturally in such an alkaline hydrothermal vent system. A different paper, the 2013 Synthesis of Aldehydic Ribonucleotide and Amino Acid Precursors by Photoredox Chemistry, presents another independent method by which the precursors of both amino acids and RNA could form in the ancient oceans. There isn't enough time in a single video to go through the various pathways by which organic molecules can be produced naturally, but the point is that it happens, and it happens fairly easily. Thus, producing organic molecules isn't the hard part. Furthermore, the video also seems to imply that this target protein with a specific sequence of 150 amino acids is the bare minimum of polypeptide complexity that can do anything useful or interesting, hence any intermediate would be useless. Yes, it's irreducible complexity all over again, but still completely wrong. Let's for a moment consider not elaborately folded proteins nor even long chains of polypeptides, but just short oligopeptides, which are easily produced under prebiotic conditions. What can they possibly do? Well, a lot more than one might expect. In the 2017 paper, Emergence of Native Peptide Sequences in Prebiotic Replication Networks, researchers studied oligopeptides that interacted with each other in a complex web of reactions in beta sheet peptide networks. Beta sheets are secondary structures commonly found in proteins, but here they are formed by multiple short peptides. But that's not all. The researchers of this study demonstrated that these beta sheet interactions drive non-enzymatic, selective, template-assisted replication of certain products in preference over their isomers. One of the challenging aspects of abiogenesis was providing an explanation for how life ended up with only certain isomers in their polymers, considering that biochemistry likely started with a repertoire of many different isomers. Apart from mentioning multiple studies that answer this question, the authors of this paper stated that the selective beta sheet-driven replication could be another plausible mechanism that explains this phenomenon. As the paper reads, quote, "Herein, we put forward another selection mechanism relevant to early chemical evolution since we probe the instrumental significance of non-enzymatic replication for the amplification and fixation of certain products within heterogeneous prebiotic mixtures. In particular, we demonstrate that beta sheet-driven peptide replication can be used for significant enrichment of a native condensation product in preference to some of its regioisomers and stereoisomers, and hence for correction of the evolutionary drift towards non-functional heterogeneous mixtures." Close quote. What about producing proteins naturally? Does that happen? To understand this, let's go back to that number the video provided, 10 to the 164th. This number originates with Stephen Meyer's book, Signature in the Cell. Big shock. To make this, he relies in part on a paper by Douglas Axe titled, Estimating the Prevalence of Protein Sequences Adopting Functional Enzyme Folds. Don't worry, we'll get back to this paper shortly. Axe proposes that the probability of a functional protein forming with a stable fold is 1 in 10 to the 74th. Meyer takes this number and assumes that the probability that a peptide bond will form is 1 in 2. Raising 0.5 to the negative 150th is 1.4 times 10 to the 45th. So he rounds down to 10 to the 45th. He then multiplies that by the probability of incorporating only left-handed amino acids, which he also assumes is 1 in 2. He does the same math to get 10 to the 45th. Multiplying 10 to the 74th by 10 to the 45th by 10 to the 45th gives 10 to the 164th, that number they were waving. Unfortunately, Meyer doesn't provide any citation for this 1 to 2 ratio claim whatsoever. Regardless, we now know better since many studies have shown that the formation of peptide bonds and the subsequent polymerization of amino acids can be driven by prebiotic mechanisms such as mineral surfaces commonly found in hydrothermal vents that concentrate, align, and act as absorption templates for amino acids. Thus, Meyer's claim of a random 1-to-2 ratio does not apply to the prebiotic processes that form peptide bonds. And that's the video's whole argument right there. It goes on for quite a while about a bizarre analogy involving an amoeba taking longer to crawl across the universe than it would take, according to them, to form a usable protein, before listening to the blatherings of ID proponents Anne Gager, Timothy Standish, and Paul Nelson, those last two being young Earth creationists who are not identified as such. But we're not done. Now, we're going to talk about actual data regarding protein formation, which does ironically make good use of Axe's paper. As stated in Abiogenesis Part 2, researchers have already documented that amino acids can naturally fold into proteins without cellular intervention, documented by the 2012 paper Protein Design at the Interface of the Prebiotic and Biotic Worlds, and the 2013 paper Simplified Protein Design Biased for Prebiotic Amino Acids Yields a Foldable Halophilic Protein. All of this concerns naturally forming molecules doing things independently from a cellular context. But Meyer tries countering in his book the ability of amino acids to form larger proteins by saying there's no way they could form hydrophilic and hydrophobic regions needed for folding. However, much like his numbers, there's no basis for this assertion. The aforementioned 2012 paper points out that all the amino acids implicated to be the earliest, including alanine, leucine, and valine, are, quote, intrinsically capable of supporting hydrophobic, hydrophilic patterning essential to the design of foldable polypeptides in aqueous solution, close quote. So what? It's that hydrophobic, hydrophilic process that lies at the heart of how lipid cell membranes can form, ongoing work that includes the 2016 paper, Fatty Acids Double Role in the Prebiotic Formation of a Hydrophobic Dipeptide. But you ask, sure, we have amino acids forming proteins and we have rudimentary proteins doing biological things in experiments. But how do those amino acids and proteins come to be specified by DNA? Well, you've got us for the moment on that. That is one place we'll have to say for the time being that we simply don't know. Research will likely come along in the future to illuminate the answer to this question, but we must admit our lack of knowledge in the meantime. And not yet knowing the answer doesn't mean we should throw our hands up and say, well, it must have been magic. Or aliens. One thing we can predict, though, the people doing the work aren't likely to be the ones doing anti-evolution videos. Once DNA did come to specify proteins, proteins could evolve various forms and functions, and how this process has unfolded is of great interest to researchers because certain proteins, such as enzymes, are of constant use in medicine and agriculture. This is all explained by the 2009 review paper, Exploring Protein Fitness Landscapes by Directed Evolution, which cites Axe's paper. This paper looks at the directed evolution of proteins in the lab and some successes of the process. Directed evolution employs mutating proteins, as nature would, to produce certain functions and/or folds, and these are selected by researchers. Despite most mutations being either neutral or harmful, these can still contribute towards producing products meaningful to researchers. In one instance, a protein called a recombinase was evolved to remove HIV DNA from a host's genome, documented by the 2007 paper, HIV-1 Proviral DNA Excision, using an evolved recombinase. It turns out that while some proteins are rather tolerant to mutations, meaning they are functionally stable in spite of mutations, called robustness, others evolve in their ability to generate heritable variation, increasing the number of evolutionary possibilities that are not only different, but also adaptive down the line, called evolvability. In essence, they evolve how much they evolve. How about that? This has led researchers to conclude that some proteins can rather easily evolve new functions. This is in part due to some proteins being functionally promiscuous, meaning that while the protein might have one major function, it can also have a number of other minor functions. Researchers have shown that mutations can greatly increase the functionality of the minor functions while barely, if at all, affecting the original function, as shown by the 2004 paper, The Evolvability of Promiscuous Protein Functions. The 2008 paper, How Much of Protein Sequence Space Has Been Explored by Life on Earth, shows that the vastness of functional protein sequence space, i.e. the total number of possible proteins and their respective functions, is actually completely explorable by life during the last 4 billion years it has existed on Earth. Another paper, the 2009 Protein Dynamism and Evolvability, explains how poorly packed, disordered, and conformationally diverse proteins are highly evolvable. This view of protein function isn't just useful in phylogenetics, but is also useful in, as previously mentioned, medicine and agriculture. Who said evolution doesn't have practical applications? So what does all of this mean? It means, for starters, that anti-evolutionists are totally wrong when it comes to proteogenesis. They make laughable assertions about the probability of certain events occurring and don't base any of these statistics in experiments or observations. In reality, we see that amino acids and other macromolecules form readily in certain solutions, that these can fold into proteins, and that proteins can easily evolve new forms and functions. I think it's time for anti-evolutionists to find a new hobby. So, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.